How long does it take to build an app?
Forever.
Yes.
Really good.
Typically, we plan an initial release of an application around the 6-month mark, but then you'll continue iterating on that product forever. And you'll kind of go through different cycles of product development and feature development. And then you'll go into cycles where maybe you're not building on the product, but you are supporting it. And so that support goes on indefinitely as long as the product's around.
I've got a product idea. Where do I start?
I would say the first place to start is looking for a potential group of users that can validate that you're right. I think we talk to a lot of people that have ideas, and ideas are awesome. We live off of ideas. I've got a bunch of ideas, but actually taking the time and going and talking to potential users or our customers and saying, I've got this idea, would you be interested? I think it's just a simple way to start. It's very much based on a lean model of saying, how do you build an MVP? An MVP can just be a conversation or a little sketch, back of a napkin kind of experience. But then also I think, you know, taking that one step further is to say, how do you find someone who can help you bring that idea into reality? So that might mean teaching yourself some new skills or finding somebody to partner with to make it a reality.
What if I don't know what product to make, but I know that there are a few pain points that technology may fix?
I would say the first thing is also to go do research. There may already be on the product in the market. A lot of times, the market is saturated with a lot of products right now. And so a lot of times it's to understand, is there something already out there? And is it serving or solving that problem well already?
Not every good idea needs to be a product. There's a lot of people who might have a good idea, but their passion and where they want to put their energy isn't aligned with that.
What is a sign that an off-the-shelf solution is failing the company?
It probably depends on the size of the company. You'll hear complaints or you'll see loss of productivity in some way. So there are going to be signals that say, this thing we put in place ought to be serving us well. We should be getting more done, or we should be seeing a higher level of engagement from our people because we have this product in place. If the assumption is that the tool ought to have done something and it's not doing that, then I think you just need to take a close look at saying, it's okay to cut things. The number of products that Crema's used over the years and then cut is a lot because we wanted to find the right product for the stage that we were at in our growth.
These companies, their job is to grow the account. And so we meet with a lot of companies that they started off paying $10,000 a year for a license, and now they're paying hundreds of thousands of dollars a year because the company keeps adding services and fees on it. And it eventually gets to a point where it's untenable to move forward with that solution. It actually becomes less expensive to build your own solution.
SaaS products are meant to be common denominator products a lot of times. You might have something that is very niche focused, like a CRM for real estate agents or something like that, right? Well, that's pretty rare. Most of the time you're gonna have a CRM for anybody and real estate agents can use it, but it's not custom made for real estate agents. So what we end up seeing is that people will grab onto a product that feels like it will fit them because it feels like it fits everybody, like Salesforce or something like that. Not to dog on Salesforce, it's fine.
It does what it does.
When you need a product that actually is fitting your custom needs, that's when we really enter the situation of talking about what might it look like to build your own.
What's one thing you need to consider before pursuing building custom tech?
Do you want to be a tech company? The number of organizations that we talk to that's like, well, I want a piece of technology, but I'm not really interested in what it takes to manage and own that piece of technology. So if you want to build and own it and run it and have that be part of your business, then you need to be prepared for the total model shift to thinking like a tech company, or at least having a segment of your organization think like a tech company.
What's the advantage of hiring you versus my own team?
Right now, it's hard to find talent. And what we've done is created a place where people want to come build products. And so not only does it draw in the talent that our clients are gonna need, but then we have the systems and processes and approaches to actually bring those people together quickly to get started on work at a better and higher quality. I think that's what a lot of new companies trying to build products struggle with. They don't know how to hire the people. They don't know how to train the people. They don't know how to equip the people to get the outcomes that they want.
How important is choosing the right vendor?
I mean, we're a recovery vendor for a lot of folks. Most of the people we've worked with have either been a part of a team or had they themselves have hired other vendors, other agencies, other service providers, and have had a not great experience, which is honestly saddening because I want more people to have a great experience working with agencies, but it's hard to do it well. And so I think finding the right partner, someone you can trust, someone that you can lean on, someone that you can collaborate with in a radical way, that is the most important piece. Someone who promises the moon and more is probably lying.
Do you have a strict screening process on who to work with?
Yes. We screen clients on kind of three core areas. One is just the overall company in general. Are they growing? Do they have a strong history? What's happening in their industry and trends overall? Typically, companies that are in crises are going to be very hard to convince to invest in product. So we're really looking at what's the health of the company and what's happening in their industry. We then are evaluating the team that we would be working with. So we're really looking at what's their experience level, how do they communicate, how do they respond to feedback that's given. And you know, at the end of the day, it's really a partnership where people are gonna be working together. So we're looking at those. The final thing is the project altogether. And you know, sometimes there are elements of a product build that we can't tackle. You know, somebody wants a artificially intelligent, you know, manufacturing line, you know,
robot.
What a robot thing. There are very few companies that can deliver something like that. So the project has to be within the scope of what our capabilities are, and we're always adding to our capabilities.
How can my app become competitive in an already established market?
If you can come up with a unique value prop that anchors on a slightly different position than your competitors, maybe solving the same problem but in a slightly different way, you can stand out pretty easily. We've seen that happen in a number of different markets. If there is competitors in the market, it's a validated market. It means that there's already product market fit. There's a desire, there's a demand there. I think the second thing that we see a lot, and it's our heartbeat as an organization, is user experience. You can get somebody to build a product that maybe there is something already out there that's checking the boxes, it functionally does the thing, but it's just kind of not great to use, then people will switch because they want something that brings pleasure while still solving the problem. And I think user experience is a big piece of that.
Can you fix an existing app?
Sometimes.
Yeah, sometimes is the right answer. Sometimes it's worth it and sometimes it's not. I've come into some rooms with some apps.
Appetizers?
Appetizer, like calamari. I'm thinking of some examples of some applications that I've come in and they go, well, we don't know why it's not working. It does everything. First off, if somebody says it does everything, that's usually why it's not working. It depends on what you mean by fixing. If fixing is people don't want to use it, then there's a bigger conversation about, did you actually solve the problem or did you build the product you wanted? I think the second thing is if it's broken, functionally it's not working, is it a development issue where, you know, libraries need to be updated or something like that? Well, yeah, that's maybe an easier approach. But I think the bigger question is looking at it and going, will it be cheaper to start over or start fresh or maybe start with an existing product and build on top of it, or to deal with the brownfield thing that we have? So if you think about brownfield being an existing product and greenfield being a new product, sometimes it's easier to go greenfield.
What kind of support or feedback would I receive as a client working with Crema?
We start every engagement with what we call a product lab. And it's pretty funny when we work with clients, we might be meeting with their whole leadership team and they all think that they're aligned on what this product is intended to do for the company. And then we actually get everyone in the room and over the course of a couple days, we find out that as leaders, they're actually not aligned. They have a different vision of how the product's gonna integrate into what they have, what kind of value it's gonna provide to customers. The first place we really start is around alignment. And so it's not only getting both teams aligned, you know, between companies, but it's really getting the client aligned on what we're actually there to build. From there, we move into regular periods where we'll be checking in, we give progress updates, we do monthly leadership calls. We're constantly working with each other and communicating on pretty much a daily basis. It's usually virtually, and then we have some regular stand-ups and sprint meetings where we review what's being done. But it is a very active process to be a client with Crema. It is not a passive process like, here's the thing, go build it and come back in 6 months. That never works out. And I think that's why a lot of projects fail. We have to build this together, and that's the only way that it'll be successful. So it's highly collaborative. There's a lot of touch points, and you get to interact with everyone on our team. That's the other thing too, is you get to interact with the developers that are building your product, the designers that are designing your product. They're essentially an extension of your team. If that sounds enticing, let's have a conversation.
What does the go-to-market process look like?
The go-to-market process will include everything from making sure that you're testing with an early customer market and then ready for it to scale. It's one thing to say like, oh, we built the thing, I'm ready for 1 million users. Most of the time, that's not the case. What you really wanna be thinking about is how do I engage those first early adopters that are gonna be my ambassadors, that are gonna be the people that give us real honest feedback? Because if we haven't solved the problem, we need to know that early. Because if we open it up to 1,000 customers or 10,000 customers or 1 million customers, and it's not solving the problem, we're going to burn a lot of cash for something that actually isn't, you know, generating market revenue or market opportunity. On the flip side, we build a lot of products for internal teams as well. So usually it's almost the exact same story. It's an internal ambassador that is willing to try to use the product and to take on the risk of saying, yeah, I get that this is new. I get that it's probably got some rough edges and that we're gonna iron things out together, give honest feedback and make it better so that the company or the agency has actually built a product that's gonna be best for the users or the customers.
When are you done building an app?
Never.
Never.
Well, it is never if the app has the potential to grow. I do know there are solutions that do what they need to do, and they probably don't need to do anything more.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think it depends on what you're building. If you're building a product that has the potential to grow, then it's never done. You're gonna be iterating on it, you're gonna be improving it, you're gonna be doing more to it to serve the customer better. There are times when maybe you're building a middleware, a product that sits between two products, and once it kind of is hooked up and is working properly, the biggest thing that you'll have to worry about is upgrading it, is making sure that if there's bugs, we can respond to them properly, mm-hmm. and if anybody has a support issue, you can mm-hmm. get on it quickly. But it maybe doesn't need full-time resources. But look at the top tech companies. If you're building a tech product, the top tech companies never stopped hiring developers. They never stopped hiring product teams. They always continued to add to it because they saw greater and greater value.
Yeah, and I would say it's very rare for a technology company to only have one product. Sure, you get one product that reaches maturity, and then there's going to be other products that you have. In fact, you know, when you do look at the big companies, take Meta or whatever, they probably have thousands of products in their product suite, or Google as well. Every company that we work with usually has multiple products, which creates this complexity of how do these products work together,
mm-hmm.
and how do we create a cohesive experience across all of them. So it really can be, if you're building a technology company, that's what you're going to be doing. You're going to be building and supporting technology by definition for the lifespan of that company.
Our largest client, we started off with one simple product. And as they grew, they realized, oh, well, that actually tacks into this other product that we already had, but that means that we need to go back and look at the API that they both talked to, and that needs to be updated. And then that API gave us an opportunity to build another product next to it, and it all ends up being this product suite, more than thinking about, is the product done?
Mm-hmm.
Will I be able to maintain or make updates to the product after handoff?
Yes, if you have a team. Early on, we used to talk about, especially when we're working with startups, we would basically say like, hey, let us help you hire our replacements. In the sense that someone who is going to be sitting here and just looking at this product by itself only for the rest of its life, right? I think with our larger clients, our enterprise clients, we'll look to say, hey, how can we continue to support you for a long period of time? Until you either have, you know, some folks inside your organization that can kind of learn and take hold of it, or you maybe need to hire up a team yourself that can maintain it long term, or you find another partner that really is more of a maintenance partner than a innovation team partner.
What skills do my team members need in order to maintain the product?
That's usually a part of our collaboration together, is we're going to be talking about what are your plans to support the product long term. If we're not involved, who are you going to hire? What skill sets do you need? It varies product to product, and it's really based on, you know, what is the product built in, what are the needs moving forward. You know, sometimes if it's just a small application, you might be able to get more of a junior dev. But if you're doing big feature development, this product's going to be onboarding lots of clients. You need to have really a product team. So it's going to vary, but that's part of our process, is making sure that when we're no longer touching it, you're well supported. Because the last thing we want to do is build a product that isn't successful or supported. You know, we're in the business of wanting to see these products actually go out and make a difference in the world. And there's nothing worse than building something that nobody uses. Thank you.